if you want to know where the future's going, you need to talk with people who are investing in it, because they usually see 2 to 3 years ahead of the rest of us, and they get pitched all the time by entrepreneurs who are trying to build the future. And today we have a special guest from Menlo Ventures who's going to tell us about what he's seeing in both the enterprise and consumer. Who are you?
Venky Ganesan, Menlo Ventures, reformed entrepreneur trying to see what the venture capital life is all about.
Which is trying to find the future, right?
Yeah, and working with great people. I think part of what makes this business really fun is that you get to see passionate entrepreneurs coming in who really want to change the world. Sometimes they succeed, sometimes they don't, but they never stop trying.
Yeah. For people who don't live in your world or who are living in somewhere else in the world, Brazil or Germany or whatever, what's Sand Hill Road like, and how do you see Menlo fitting into that? Because you guys are on Sand Hill Road, right?
Yeah.
There's like, I don't know, how many venture capital firms are there?
Too many.
Yeah, too many.
So we have a unique perspective, right? Yeah. We've been around for 38 years. We were actually the first tenant in 3000 Sand Hill. We had the first phone number, 650-854-8540. So we have seen many people come, some go. I think what makes Sand Hill special in one way is the fact that people believe, what if? As in, the rest of the world thinks, okay, this is not gonna happen. We like to think about, what if it does happen? Yeah. And that's how sort of the crazy ideas come, is, right? What if it really happens? What if you could get a kid from Harvard and actually connect up the whole world and have a social network that does it? And I think that's what makes Sand Hill special, is those two things. One is what if, and thinking about failure not as an end destination, but as a midpoint towards learning and success. Yeah. And I think that's a cultural value that I think that's pretty unique to Silicon Valley.
You know, the press focuses on what was successful yesterday, right? Nest selling for $3 billion to Google, or PrimeSense selling to Apple for $1 billion, or all the stuff that's happened in the last year or two, Twitter going public, sure, Facebook going public, right? You guys, though, are trying to aim at 2 to 8 years out, right? And you're trying to figure out what's gonna be big, yeah, you know, which is hard to do, because, you know, we don't know all of the, you know, how good is the wearables gonna, yeah, be, or on and on. What are you seeing today that might affect 2 or 3 or 4 years from now?
It's a great question, Robert, but I think there's one very important statement I want to make. Venture guys don't invent the future, don't drive the future.
Well, they don't drive it in terms of, you're not the R&D lab, you're not building the sensors or the technology, but you get to see it first. You get to see it even earlier than I do.
That's right.
And then you get to decide, do you put money on it? Do you put some wood behind it?
Right? Yeah, what I was trying to say is the entrepreneurs, the ones who come to us, they're the, yeah, ones who drive it, right? Yeah. And so I always try to say, look, what I do is I try to be a facilitator. I get the opportunity, right? It's a real opportunity to get some of the smartest people in the world to come through our doors, tell me what they're thinking, and then occasionally we get invited to join them on that journey. And so I always know that it's the entrepreneurs who drive. And, yeah, and I think what I find that's pretty interesting today is that we have a very unique time in history. You have this big mega trends all happening at the same time that sort of has never happened before.
Like when?
Well, so just let's think about the idea of mobile. The idea that everyone has basically computing power, perhaps greater than the computing power that took the man to the moon.
Way greater, actually.
Way greater, sitting on their sort of pockets with them all the time, that effectively makes every person on Earth a two-way signal, right? Yeah. A way to receive it and a way to send information.
Well, and you're carrying around sensors that didn't exist, right? It knows. I just had a company, Sensor Platforms was just here a couple days ago. They can tell whether the phone is in your pocket or in your hand or walking. Or, you know, and there's lots of apps now that know that you're riding a bike or walking or running or in your car.
So you, now we're all wired. We have an incredible emerging cloud platform. What that means is that we're going to have intelligent, dynamic, right now services that are going to change how we live, play, write, and work. A good example of an intelligent, dynamic, right now service is Uber. If you think about Uber, the part of what makes Uber work is the fact that everyone who signs up and asks for a car is now sending information out to a cloud service that says there's demand here. Yet they also know where the supply is, and they can direct the supply, and they can mash that up in a right now intelligent manner. And the key thing is they don't actually take reservations. They've actually gone from saying, I don't want ever to take reservations. I'm going to connect supply and demand in a right now way.
Yeah.
And that's the kind of service that's going to get really interesting. And we, you know, another company that I'd like to talk about is Handle, because I think Handle is going to do something similarly that can only work in today's context.
What Handle is, which?
Handle is an email company that we are incubating in our offices. One of my partners, Sean Carolyn, is actually running the company. And it's really rethinking the email inbox for the mobile world, right? Today, email is this incredible time sink.
Yep.
Probably it is the one application in which everyone around the world, probably the billion knowledge workers, spend probably an hour and a half. They're frustrating, and it doesn't feel intelligent at all. I'll give you an example of what can be intelligent, right? You probably get 1,000 emails a day, people saying, Robert, I'd like to talk to you about this. Now, what you want is something intelligent to say, first figure out which one's important,
yep.
And then you're going to probably be commuting for some portion of the day. You want to line up some phone calls to happen when you are commuting so they can come through your Bluetooth and talk.
Yep.
Handle can do that. You, with one little swipe, you can say, make sure that I call this person on my next commute. And automatically, because your iPhone has a sensor and your Android phone will have a sensor, it'll know when you're driving in a car and it'll ask you, would you want to do those calls now?
Oh, that's cool.
And there's no reason why
that comes. So it's a new kind of task list almost.
Yeah. And so the idea is that these are right now services that are intelligent and dynamic. That's the key phrase, intelligent and dynamic. Yep. And that can be personalized for you.
That's why I like a company called Tap and Go, which I think Vinod Khosla just invested in. And it stalks you. It's for students right now, so most people haven't seen it yet. But it surveils you as you live your life as a student. You buy everything through Tap and Go, your books, your sandwich, your coffee, and after a while it gets smart about who you are and asks you, would you like your normal coffee this morning?
Right, and there's no reason why, because we all are creatures. Like, we have this company, Dropcam.
Yeah.
And for those who are not familiar with it, it's a incredibly easy to use Wi-Fi camera, right?
Yeah.
It's actually one of the few products, third-party products featured on the Apple Store. Okay, that's not new. A Wi-Fi camera is not new. Something that's easy, that's great. But what's really unique about Dropcam is that they're able to take that video, upload it to the sky, and understand the pattern. And if you had, in my house, the pattern is everybody kind of leaves by 9 o'clock, and then the kids start coming back around 4 o'clock. Between 9 to 4, really nothing happens. And so Dropcam doesn't shoot that on HD anymore.
Yep.
They downgrade it to the lowest level, and they actually start sample it.
Unless somebody comes and steals your Amazon package.
But they have, and that's what I mean by an intelligent, right? They have a movement sensor.
Yeah.
But if they pick that sensor, suddenly they upgrade to HD and go on because they recognize the movement. And that's, to me, an example of an intelligent dynamic right now service that previously would have just been a dumb camera with the same feed all the time.
Well, let's talk, that's home automation. And there's a lot happening. I just was at the Consumer Electronics Show. There's a reason that Google bought Nest for $3 billion, right? If you can get more sensors in the house, you can really figure out somebody's intent in a new way.
Yeah.
You know, even turning up the heat is intent. Google wants to be an intent satisfaction company. A lot of people don't look at their company that way, but I do, and everything fits into that, right?
Right. They want to read your mind before you can read it.
Yeah, so we're going to see new. I just saw a new audio device coming. That's really cool. A social audio device, like Sonos, but even better. We have the Nest thermostats. We have all sorts of things, from sensor cubes to all sorts of sensors that are going to be in your house to study different things.
Yeah.
And then I use a Revolve unit, which hooks together all that stuff. So I have my Dropcam hooked in, my Sonos, my Nest. My Philips Leist.
Roku.
I don't have a Roku because I have a Chromecast and an Apple TV. I figure those two are going to win over the.
You got to upgrade to the best product in the market.
Yeah, well, you know, there's only so much TV I can watch a day. But the home automation thing, I have Philips lights, I have all, and more and more is coming out to automate what's going on in your house and augment what's going on in your house. And Revolve has 9 radios and it grabs them all. So I have a feeling Revolve is going to get bought pretty soon too, because Nest sort of set a baseline that at least Google's interested in this world.
Right.
But I know Microsoft is interested in the home. They have Xbox, right? There's a reason they spent how many billions of dollars building Xbox as a brand up?
3 or 4.
Or more. Remember, the press always used to be mad at Microsoft. You're spending $1 billion a quarter building Xbox. Why? You have Windows, you know? And Bill Gates understood owning the home is really important. So Microsoft has aspirations to own the home. Apple has aspirations to own the home. Google has aspirations on the home. And that's just home, right? Then we can talk about cars.
Yeah, and I think in each of that, there's something deep going on, which is that we are taking these household mundane objects and trying to make them really intelligent, right? Probably what makes, it's not about the thermostat. It's about the idea about taking all those objects that are sitting around your house today that are dumb, hard to use, and have no intelligence to them, and incorporating intelligence, right? And what happens with Nest is there's 2 levels of intelligence. There's a local intelligence that takes into account what is your behavioral pattern. And then there is the network intelligence that says, oh my God, everybody is switching on at the same time their AC. Is there a way we can get some Nest customers to move back on the thermostat a little bit, and that'll reduce the demand load on the utilities?
Oh, and save the money. My Nest has already paid for itself after 4 months, right? Because it reduced my heating bill enough to pay for the device, right?
And think about all the other objects that are around, you know, your home that today are dumb, right? Yeah. I mean, I'll give you a simple example.
Sprinkler system.
Sprinkler system, that's a great water usage. I was actually going for something even more mundane as just your photo frames, right? You know, your photo frames can be easily, you can just plug it to your, you know, iPhoto and have it intelligently pick pictures depending upon what the environment is. And there's no reason for that not to be an intelligent system that says, oh, you know, show a different kind of picture in the morning versus a different kind of picture in the evening. Doesn't save as much money as your sprinkler system, but it just gives you a sense about what you can imagine a world where the objects around us are actually intelligent and dynamic.
Yeah. That's going to be continuing to be a trend because the cell phone industry is forcing all sorts of prices to come down. PrimeSense, for instance, that got bought by Apple last year at Consumer Electronics Show, their 3D sensor was $100.
Right.
This year I saw a similar sensor that actually was better for $20. Yeah. So the cost is coming down extremely fast on sensors and all sorts of small compute packages. You saw Intel announce a new computer on a chip. That's going to open up new kinds of capabilities, right?
Yeah, and that's what I think maybe people from the outside don't fully grok, which is that the phone, the smartphone in general, is riding down the price of sensor technology for everything, right? So for example, cameras have gone a lot cheaper because you have this volume with smartphones that allows you to now drive down that cost. Fingerprint sensors are going to get really cheap because, again, you have this volume. Semiconductors are driven by volume, and if you can pick an item that is going to be in the hundreds of millions, then you can put very sophisticated technology and drive the cost down really fast. That's pretty exciting. So to me, the kind of sensors you can now build, and this forces the batteries to get better. And so we are riding these curves that are going to result in us having, you know, a tremendous number of intelligent dynamic things.
Yeah. Are you... At Menlo, do you look at these different areas and say we need something in home automation or something in cars or something in batteries? Or how do you guys figure out what your investment mix is going to be?
So, I mean, the history of Menlo is very research-driven. We end up picking an area that we think is going to be interesting and big, spend a lot of time trying to think about, you know, what are the defining characteristics of the winners, and then go and find the market-leading companies and invest in it, right? I'll give you an example. A couple of years back, we felt like mobile marketplaces are going to be really, really interesting for a variety of reasons. And we decided that that's an area we wanted to focus on. We were lucky enough to be an early investor in Uber. That's turned out to be quite an interesting company.
Yeah.
We invested in a company called Poshmark, which again makes, if you're not familiar with it, it's a mobile marketplace around women's closets. It allows you to go into your closet, take pictures, and put those items, whether those are dresses or shoes for sale that you may not use anymore, and then hopefully sell that and then use that money to buy more stuff.
Yeah.
That's what my wife does. So. and what I mean by that is mobile marketplaces are very interesting. We had a thesis, we went in, we looked at all the companies, ended up investing in companies like Uber and Poshmark. We've done the same thing for storage, done the same thing for ad tech. And that's the approach we take. Have a thesis, think about where we think the world is gonna go, and go and find the best companies in the space.
Yeah. But, you know, I know enough venture capitalists that they are just like—
I'm sorry you know that many venture capitalists.
I know, quite a few. They are sort of like humans. They decide they like you right away, and then they justify it or do due diligence to make sure that they are not getting fooled by that initial impression. What gets you initially to go, oh my God, I like this guy or I like this girl?
You know,
this entrepreneur.
We all are prisoners of our own experiences, and the people at Menlo are, you know, what I could call in the hungry camp. We all came from very middle class backgrounds. A lot of us were the financial aid students in the colleges we went to, and we came in, and so we kind of value hunger more than anything else. What I really look for when I see someone is someone who's really passionate, who's going to do this regardless of whether I'm going to get involved or anybody's going to get involved.
Yeah.
You know, to me, that stay hungry, stay foolish is the defining characteristics of what technology and entrepreneurship is about. So to me, it's all about hunger.
GoPro is a good example of that, right? He built the company. Well, let's say it was $150,000. It was $10,000 initially that he raised by selling seashells.
And right.
You know, used his mom's sewing machine to build the prototype and made it happen, right? And
yeah.
Didn't need venture capital, at least not at first. He took it later to really gas up and become a world brand. Do you see that as changing about venture capital too? Because a company like GoPro 20 years ago would actually need venture capital to get started because it was so expensive to build a company.
Yeah, so you have all these things that make entrepreneurship easier and entrepreneurship more capital efficient. There is absolutely a role for venture capital still because you need money to scale, you need money to marketing, but whether you need, in some categories, you don't need money to build a product. And GoPro is a great example of something where if he actually had gone to venture capitalists and said, I want to build this ruggedized camera that people are going to wear and take pictures on, he would have done is spend a lot of time on Sand Hill raising zero. Right, but he went out and pursued something that he really believed in. It was a problem he understood and he felt passionate about because, you know, he went on a surfing trip and he realized that he wanted to take pictures of him surfing and there was no real way to do that without another person with him. And I think that's the core essence of entrepreneurship, is trying to find something that you're passionate about. It's a real problem, and if you solve it, makes a big market. And if you can get to that intersection of those three Venn diagrams.
Although in the early days, I don't even know that he knew it was that big a market because
he did.
Know, how many surfers are there in the world and how many cameras can they buy? You know, he probably was thinking, oh, I'll just build a nice little business for myself and not really become a billionaire, right?
Oh, totally.
Which he did.
It's easy
to see all this stuff in hindsight, right? But when you're just starting a company, it's hard.
The most interesting companies are started not because they think it's a big market, because a lot of times those markets don't exist, but they're started because of a personal passion around that problem. You know, one of Menlo's most famous companies is a company called Gilead Sciences, which is, you know, a big $100 billion company today. It started off because one of my partners came back in December with the flu and said, why don't we have antivirals? We have antibiotics. Why don't we have antivirals? And he asked Mike Riordan, who was an associate then, to say, go and find out why we don't have antivirals. And that's how this whole category of antivirals started.
Wow.
And so to me, that's the genesis. The starting point is come up with something that's a deep personal problem that you are passionate about solving.
Yeah. What else should we know about what's going on right now? You know, we could certainly go down a whole bunch of tips for entrepreneurs, but those have been written on Quora.
I think about the issues that we are going to face in a world where we have intelligent dynamic right now services is really privacy and security.
Yeah.
And I think security is going to become, it's already a big issue, but it's going to get a bigger and better issue.
Explain what you mean by security, because to a data center company, that means something different than it probably means to you.
Right. Well, there are multiple dimensions of security. There's security at the country level, where we need to make sure that as a country, we don't have other countries spying on us. There's security at the enterprise level, where enterprises need to make sure their data is secure. And then there's security at the individual level, where you have a sense that what you do online and your identity can be protected. And I think it's important to think about all of those dimensions, because we are getting assaulted on that security spectrum every way. And we need to rethink security.
It's a tough thing, because on my phone I have 300 apps, right? And right. A lot of these apps have a lot of my private data. Uber has my credit card, TripIt has my credit card and has access to my email, right? And Google has access to everything. and Foursquare has access to my location, and on and on and on, right? How do you build personal security privacy in that new world? I call it a contextual world, where you're going to have hundreds of services studying you as you live your life and buy things and go into museums and stuff like that.
So I say we don't need more security products, we need more secure products, which means that everything you use, everyone who's building an app needs to think about security as one of their design features from day one. They need to think about encrypting your information at every atomic level on day one. And if you don't, people are going to move away from your app. This, you know, immense popularity of Snapchat is driven by this need that people say, I want a little more control over my content. I hate the fact that people are using my content in ways I did not envision when I started using that app.
Yeah.
And that's a crying need. And I think we need to think about secure products.
Let's talk about Snapchat, because outside of the Valley, people are like, $3 billion and he turned it down? Right?
Even inside the Valley, there's inside the Valley, $3 billion, he turned it down.
At Menlo, what would your advice be to Evan, who runs Snapchat? Would you have taken the money? Do you see a business there? Do you see a way for him to build a real company? Because right now it's in that pre-revenue phase where he doesn't have any ads, he doesn't charge his customers, his users anything. So there's no business there yet. How do you turn that into a business?
I first of all, I don't know Evan, but I really, really respect him for the decision he made, because it shows me that he is really motivated about changing the world. Because it's probably the easiest thing in the world. 99 people would take the $3 billion, right?
Yeah.
But he's saying, I care deeply about this. It's not just about the money, though the money is important. It's also about changing the world. And my advice to him would be to really look, you know, and I'm sure he's already done it, so it's not new advice, but if the data is there, if the engagement is there, and people are coming back and they're using it, then I think communication is one of those, is the stickiest thing in the world. We are wired to be social animals.
Right, but he has an expectation that you're not going to use that data against you.
Right.
That data, you know, if I send you a photo or a video in Snapchat, that thing goes away.
Right.
And so if he starts doing things that prove that it didn't go away, it really messes with everybody's brand of what Snapchat is.
Maybe, right? Or maybe not, right?
In other words, how do you build a business with that?
So I'll get to that in a second, right? Yeah. But I'll give you an example. When we invested in Hotmail, so Menlo was the largest investor in Hotmail, and when Microsoft bought Hotmail for $400 million in, I want to say, 97, it was unheard of. That was a Snapchat of its day, because until then, nobody had ever heard of a company with no revenues being bought for $400 million, right? But why did Microsoft do it? Because email, they realized, was just that killer app that everybody would want to do. And so when people come in, and if I had other things I could sell, I could move people to the other things I could sell because I had brought them in. And so I could acquire a lot of people very cheaply because of free email.
Yep.
I think Snapchat has the same kind of value. So if, for example, Yahoo buys it, they have an incredible number of properties in which they could move people today, but they're not getting a lot of folks. Snapchat would be a great way for them to get a mobile app and mobile audience, and they might not do anything with the Snapchat service, but it becomes so valuable as a sticky product, they can move them to other places, right? And that's not very different from what Facebook did with Instagram. And that's the same reason why Zuckerberg is interested in Snapchat, because he understands that at the core, you need to have something that brings people in every day and keeps them engaged. Yeah. And that's what Snapchat has.
Very cool. Anything else you want to tell me about what you're seeing in the world, from the entrepreneurs? Because you have a whole bunch of entrepreneurs every day visiting you, and you get to see stuff probably a year before I do, right?
Right. Well, first of all, I'd say incredible, amazing time to be an entrepreneur. This is the kind of time you want to be in, because you have all these changes. I guess the most important message I'll say is don't get distracted, because right now we're getting to the point where it's very easy. I remember, so I'll tell you a funny story. When I was a student at Caltech, I got invited to a Hollywood party, right? And you know, if you're a nerdy guy at Caltech, being in a Hollywood party is like the most amazing thing. Yeah. So when you go in there, the mistake I made was like, I was so amazed at being there. I was looking at everything and distracted by everything that I didn't spend the time to actually talk to people and spend time building relationships there. And I think the biggest risk you have as an entrepreneur right now is you can be distracted by all the things that are going on and not spend time on doing the things that's important to you. So just focus, ignore the noise, focus on what really matters.
Very cool. Where do we find you online? Are you on Twitter or Facebook?
I am on Twitter, so at Venky Ganesan on Twitter. Okay. You can find me there, and you can find me on the Menlo blog.
Very cool. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks.